So first off, how about we just go around the circle and say our name and our preferred gender pronouns and maybe some interests and passions and also what brought you to this workshop. So I'm Kikue and my preferred gender pronouns are she, her, and hers. And I'm interested in prisoner letter writing. I'm interested in social club. I've been involved with that a lot. Right now in my life, I'm interested in learning more about addiction and gender inequality. So. It doesn't matter.
Sorry.
Yeah. Wait, what's the
interests or passions?
I'm Dylan, mostly prefer gender neutral pronouns, but interests, ecology, and
I'm Rob. My preferred pronouns are his, he, and him. My passions are art. And I'm here to support you in the lessons you learn. Interesting topic.
And fiction as a means of like storytelling to support like new ways of thinking, that kind of stuff. And environmental anarchism is one I'm interested in getting involved in, forest defense kind of stuff.
Yeah. I just got here, I'm sorry.
So you say your name, your gender pronouns, and something
about your passion. Okay, I am Alan Time. Him. Is totally fine. Something I'm passionate about. I like movies a lot. Like I even started a film club here. It didn't work out, but I mean, started it. And I mean, I also enjoy the criminology field, figuring out what causes crime, any corruption within each of the legal systems. So, yeah.
My name is Dabney. She, her, and her. I am passionate right now about the death penalty. I'm doing my senior summer project on like this discriminatory policy in Alabama and in Florida that allows the judge to override jury verdicts of life in prison to death. And something I'm passionate about, which kind of links to prison writing. So.
Cool. We're starting off with asking you guys some questions, and it's going to be a discussion. And so.
Yeah, chime in. We don't have to go around the circle, right?
No. Just,
yeah.
So, how many of you guys have been to prisoners before?
Okay. Do you want to share this? You two come to five.
I've only done it once. I
okay. Cool. Do you like birthday cards? It's an easy starter.
What stigmas are associated with prisons and prisoners?
They're broken and rotten. I mean, it's a stigma, you know, discrimination. they're in there because of what they did instead of any outside forces that caused them to be on their head.
The assumption that because they're there, they aren't worthy of entry, and that's you, which is forgiveness.
Generally passionate about anarchism. I am particularly passionate about prison work too, and abolition.
And I'm Nancy, and I'm passionate about multicultural, multiracial, and gender issues.
Have you guys ever written to prisoners before?
Just once, I sent a postcard to the ELF prisoner, who's at Dublin, sort of close to where I am. Yeah. I'm still a little bit not sure what to say, what not to say.
Right.
Yeah.
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 So a lot of my research right now with the death penalty and stuff, I've been reading this book and trying to contact this man. His name's Brian Stevenson, and he's a death penalty abolitionist. Anyway, he has this thing in his book, it's so powerful, and he says human beings are more than the worst thing that they've ever done. And I think that's so true. Even people who have committed horrible crimes or for kids or whatever, there's still learning on it, and I think that something that should be addressed.
Especially since I can't speak for you, but after writing to prisoners this past semester in the Prisoner Letter Writing Club, the people that I've been talking to don't seem like bad people. And they seem like people who make mistakes, like everyone. So they're just getting harsher consequences for what they did. Can you guys think of any other stigmas?
Kind of going off through the mass sort of ideal. It kind of goes further than prisoners, though. It kind of also goes into more of the judicial system because, if you're a defense attorney and you're defending someone who's been accused, people assume it's like, why would you be defending someone who committed a crime? Bring that sort of stigma saying that, wow, they're no good. They shouldn't be equally defended. And you can see that and other states with their defense attorney system for it. They just bring anyone that has any degree in law. So you can have an environmental lawyer try and defend you in court, which most of the time doesn't go out well. I mean, I know Colorado has the best defense attorney system, but I mean, it's still pretty bad. Yeah.
My dad was a lawyer, and I remember like being like really little. How do you like defend someone that has told you that they were? I just couldn't even understand it. You'd always say it's like it's not my job to like judge them. I have to like represent them because they deserve to be proven guilty in the state.
It's not so much as a stigma, more like a philosophical presumption in a justice system. I think justice is retributive, reconciling or healing in that way. So you're stuck in prison for a number of years and you're just paying the crime. I don't care about if you're getting better or if you're being reconciled with people that you did wrong to or anything like that. It doesn't matter in our system.
It's about punishment rather than harming again. That's the difference between like retributive justice and restorative justice, right?
I read online about people like condoning like prison rape. Like I hope so and so goes to jail and gets raped like every day. I was like, what?
Yeah.
So yeah, I mean it's just if you're not, I feel like if you're not in that, you see it in, I mean, not everyone obviously, but like the general public sees it as like it's just so detached and it's like, oh, they're bad people, that's where all the bad people go and they get what they deserve there, you know.
Just there, but they also have that pity to those on these like you're never forgiven or you're never the ones that you're always the cheer, ones in prison, always the prisoner. So just, yeah.
It's very hard for prisoners to integrate back in the society.
Like the little box.
Reconciliation-focused stuff. I mean, it can help, I feel like, to reach out to prisoners in that way and, like, sort of show kindness or empathy or understanding in the first place. You know, like maybe the like specific situation or system that you're in right now doesn't really care about this, but you know, like there are people who do care.
Yeah, to give hope, to reduce isolation.
There's a real sense in the prison system you've lost a lot of your rights. You can't leave a building, and like a lot of those rights that are lost, it's like it's real and it's going to be felt phenomenally by the prisoners. And you know, reaching out and contacting them kind of shows that even despite them losing these rights, they still matter. So it's kind of love.
Yeah, I think it's especially important for like activists or like political prisoners, like writing to like ELF or Earth First kind of members, people that are part of like a supportive community, and then they get sent to prison for like stuff that they're doing as a community member, and like if they're just completely cut off from this support group, then like that can just be completely demoralizing. So like writing and it, like maintaining contact and being like, yo, like we support what you did, and we're gonna like there are gonna be people here for you as soon as you get out. And, like what you did was worthwhile, even if you have to sit in prison for it.
Kind of got roped into writing to prisoners through Anthony, and I didn't really know why I was doing it at first. I just wanted to be involved, and that's why I joined. But after a while, I realized that I now write to prisoners because I think it's important to connect this outside world with that inside world. It helps me gain perspective, and it helps me be more informed so we can fight on the outside. and also it's good to write to prisoners in general because it helps destigmatize them within yourselves. Mm-hmm. And once you can do that within yourselves, it's easier for that destigmatization to take place.
That's so true.
So, but, yeah. Why do you write to prisoners, Dabney?
So I also got invited to the club by Anthony, and I've always had like a fascination with prisons for some reason. They're a forgotten population, and we don't think about them, we don't care about them, we don't care what happens to them in prison, like, just the horrible things that go on, like, even in prisons that are like, they're just horrible places. Like, people are cut off from the outside world. It's just this totally isolating place. And just to like be able to reach out and say, hey, to brighten someone's day, like just any outside connection. So that's why I do it, just because I don't want them to think that they're forgotten or that they're unworthy of being a human being on the outside. Like I said, people are like, you know, more than the worst thing. And then even people who like they didn't do anything and they're innocent or whatever, but really I guess everyone's, they're all victims in some way, I think, so, yeah.
And to let them know that we stand in solidarity with
them. Yeah, and then especially with political prisoners as well. I was writing a man who spent like 36 years on death row, a former Black Panther, and just like how forgotten he feel being in solitary for 36 years and then coming out to like general population, and like just who remembers him? Like, I know you see like the articles on Facebook or whatever that's like this prisoner like denied parole or whatever, and it's like, oh, like, okay, and that's not anything new, you know, but just to like for someone to be invested in their story, I think is important.
Do you guys think of any other reasons why it's important?
seems like the whole prison system is very intentional in breaking down like the spirits of people, and especially like with regards to political prisoners, it feels very like intentional and basically making them not do those things again. So it's important to write to them just to show your support. And even, you know, just any prisoner, because you know, you really do get dehumanized. People don't think about prisons or prisoners or anything like that, so it's very important.
Yeah. I think also from like a strategic perspective, when you write to prisoners, somebody said something a few weeks ago that made me realize this, but it's not just like, you're not always just like writing to the prisoner for them and for yourself, but it's like people sift through their mail and like see who's getting written to, and it's really letting the system know that you are keeping tabs on these people, and that like you're not gonna stand by and they're just watching you like shit.
Right. Yeah.
That's a good one.
That is a good one. Yeah, because all of the letters are looked through before they're given to the prisoner. So
they can be sent back for really stupid reasons, like using a gel pen or something. So, blue, black ink, stupid.
Right. We're going to show a clip from a documentary about Dave Gilbert. He's a political prisoner. And he talks about the prison system a little bit. And we thought it would be appropriate to show. It's about 20 minutes, I'd say. So.
That's cool. Yeah.
And then after that, we'll get into actually writing to prisoners. So, yeah.
My sentence is 75 to life. That in New York, different states and the feds have different sentencing structure, but in New York, 75, that is the minimum. It's not like they say 75, you go to void in 20 years. My first chance for parole is 2036. I got involved with Weatherman, and then what became the Weather Underground, back when we formed in 69 and 70. And we formed in the cauldron of intense struggle against the war in Vietnam and racism at the time, when the Black Panthers, who were leading force in the Black struggle that we identified with, we got cut down and assassinated at the time when we were highly charged by pictures of children in Vietnam getting involved, massive demonstrations that didn't stop the war. In that context, we came out of the radical student movement at that time, predominantly white, called Students for a Democratic Society. In the context of seeing a lot of the people who inspired us and who had led the protests getting assassinated or put in prison, and a war that was so brutal and wouldn't stop, a small section of what was the broad student movement decided we had to be in a position to carry out illegal forms of struggle against the government. I had been sort of awakened already that something was wrong by the civil rights movement. See, in terms of my early consciousness, I had never been exposed to the left or heard of the left. I believed that America was a democracy, and I took that really seriously. And I never caught the wink that it's a democracy for some people, not for other people, and I fervently believed it. And then when I saw the opening of the civil rights movement, that certain people were denied any opportunity or right to vote or anything, that was like, I went off, you could say, because I believed in this. But I still assumed that America stood for democracy abroad. What happened when I was still in high school, my best friend in high school had an exchange student from Vietnam living there. She wasn't a communist, she was an aristocratic family. But she let us know that in Vietnam, Ho Chi Minh was considered the George Washington of Vietnam, that they were the ones who fought for independence. And the so-called regime itself, government in South Vietnam, had been imposed by the United States as a continuation of French colonialism. So, this is before the bombing of North Vietnam, where the U.S. involvement in Vietnam became a public issue. I'm talking about 1961, I was 16. I wrote an article for my high school paper saying the United States was supporting the wrong side of Vietnam that was going to lead to a major civil war, and it was wrong. Well, at that time, that was considered like being crazy, ultra. You didn't, in 1961, you did not criticize U.S. bomb policy. That was considered bipartisan. You always supported it. So that was considered pretty far out there. I mean, in light of history, what developed was a pretty moderate and prudent assessment of what was going on. The civil rights movement opened up that America was not a practicing democracy. Malcolm X raised the issue of self-determination and human rights. Black power in 66 taught us that it is a nature of a power structure, and we had to deal with opposition to that power structure. And then, of course, the Panthers and other revolutionary nationalist groups of the period, in getting past 66 into 68, 69, really brought home the identification with national liberation struggle and the right for people to fight against their oppressive and racist regime for total independence. We were saying, and the early civil rights movement said, and SDS said in the early 60s, our slogan was, we're going to shake the moral conscience of America. The idea was people couldn't know that this racism was going on. They couldn't really know that we were supporting dictatorships in the third world. And once we showed them, that would stop it, because there's a moral conscience. We didn't understand the nature of the power structure. Days of Rage, as I said, that happened in 69. This is the period of the height of the police and FBI attacks on the Panthers, when we're really psyching ourselves up to take this leap. Even so, in Days of Rage, I remember when people broke through the police lines. And I wasn't on the front lines of that. I didn't knock any police over. I was in it. I was behind people. I followed them through. I do remember that was kind of a rush for this reason. So many times we've been in demonstrations trying to say stop the war, having seen pictures of napalm children, knowing the level of Agent Orange of being dropped in Vietnam, the different killings going on, and this was like outrageous, and we would say you can't do this, and the police would say, okay, you can't march here. No, you gotta stay here, you know, containing our protest. So that was a sense of excitement that people could break through in Days of Rage. I found out in those type of situations, street fighting situations, my defensive reflexes were very good. My offensive reflexes were pretty hesitant. So there was a situation where I was surrounded by a few police and I don't, with clubs, and I somehow rolled and this and that and got through it. There were times when, in terms of the purpose of the demonstration, I should have been more offensive or aggressive, and it just wasn't me, it just didn't happen. Fred Hampton and Mike Clark were shot to death December 4th, 1969. Fred Hampton was 20 years old, an extremely promising and charismatic leader of the Black Panthers. Not someone who was promoting the gun aspect of the Panthers that much, someone who had done, you know, organized free breakfast program for school children, and particularly had played a really positive role in building unity. You know, you've heard of the Rainbow Coalition, and it's an election campaign for Jesse Jackson, but the original Rainbow Coalition was headed by Fred Hampton in Chicago, and it brought together the Panthers and the Young Lords and the Young Patriots, which is a white street gang that was moving in an anti-racist way, and SDS. It was bringing together people who were oppressed or have a reason to fight the system. Between 1968 and 1971, approximately 40 Panthers were killed, and about over 1,000 were put in prison with trumped up charges. Some of them are still in prison today. If we are allies, if we're anti-racist, if we're allies in the black movement, if we want to build a movement among whites that's truly anti-racist, you can't sit and watch that happen. And it's time to move to other forms of struggle. Many of us, I have been a pacifist for many, many years before I moved to this point. And I didn't mind getting beaten or going to jail if it did some good. I couldn't stand by and watch this go on. And we felt we wanted to create some pressure to overextend the police so they couldn't concentrate all their forces on the Panthers. We wanted to create a political cost for what they were doing. And we also felt to build a movement among whites that was a revolutionary movement, a radical movement, it had to be anti-racist. And to be anti-racist, it had to respond to something when our government and our name was destroying the most promising and exciting and charismatic leadership that had come out of the black movement in a long time. Like, when Weather first went underground in the 70s, everybody on the left said, no, this is only going to last for a few months. In terms of how the actions worked and how the targets were selected for the Weather Underground, the first issue was political. What was the particular issue we were responding to? And we saw, again, our goal was to not hurt any people, and a lot of work went into that. But we wanted to pick targets that showed to the public who was responsible for what was really going on. And that was usually government or corporate. For example, when the coup happened in Chile, where the elected government of Salvador Allende was overthrown, there was a massacre by the military, thousands of people were killed. CIA, Henry Kissinger, were completely involved in this. They claimed they were for democracy, but there's an elected government that wasn't pro-business, and boom, they were gone. We did a bombing of Kennecott Copper Company, because the main metal coming out of Chile and the main economic interest in Chile was copper, and Anaconda and Kennecott were two big copper companies. One time we did one, I think we did one of the banks that was involved in U.S. control over Puerto Rico, economic control over Puerto Rico. If it was like a particular escalation of the war in Vietnam, we did bombing of the Capitol building, we did a bombing of the Pentagon. So the first point of an action was to draw home to people who are responsible for these crimes and who should be protested against attack. We didn't think bombing was the only thing to do. They should also do mass demonstrations and all levels of protest and action. Of course, a secondary factor is accessibility. Can you get there? Can you do it? And can you do it in a way that doesn't harm people? It's not an accident that we did 25 bombings without any civilian casualties. Actually, you know, this is after the townhouse movie, really terrible place in Prussia where we killed three of our own people. Three of our own people killed themselves. We made a lot of very bad mistakes in this period of time. And in retrospect, I feel it was precisely because most of us had such little experience with violence and so little relationship to violence and led really relatively sheltered lives. And as I said, for my first 7 years of activism, I was philosophically a pacifist. That to me, there was an aspect of what we did that was psyching ourselves up to make the jump over this hurdle from sort of a more comfortable middle-class life to building an underground and taking on our struggle. There was some romanticization of violence, some statements made that really are disgusting. There was the politics of the townhouse, which was sort of as a first approach to armed struggle, saying just sort of the bigger the bang, the better, rather than looking at really making actions very consistent with our humanism and our goals, and focusing on a narrow enemy and being careful that people weren't hurt. So I'd say it was this level of energy, excitement, pushing forward to take this tremendous leap, and a lot of psyching ourselves up that had some negative consequences. The other tenor was, of course, the majority of people on the left attacked us tremendously, because the idea that being a revolutionary meant actually fighting the government on that level was pretty upsetting. But there was that sense of attack and being in battle, but we in turn were extremely sectarian. Sectarian's a word within the movement, by which we mean, you know, if you're not doing things exactly like we are, you're not any good. And we were extremely arrogant towards other people. We're the only true revolutionaries. We're the only ones who are responding to the racism in the society and willing to fight. And we really turned off and alienated a lot of people who were decent people and potential allies. And not only is that a long way to deal with people, it really weakened achieving our own goals, which is to build as strong a movement as we could against the war and against racism. There was a time, as frequently happens when there's an upsurge in the black struggle, or an opening up of all other kinds of struggle, that women felt more strengthened in a more collective context and a more political context to raise some of these issues. But it was still a very male-dominant culture, and I think the first part of your question about psyching ourselves up for violence, the format we adopted was pretty macho. And women were invited to be part of our struggle, which you could say is an advance, and many women played very good important roles. But the mode of how to do it was still a macho posturing move, you know, the tougher the better, rather than a more thoughtful, humane, careful, strategic way of approaching it. How did brothers see free love as an answer to sexual repression? I'm laughing a little bit, somewhat out of embarrassment, because it's obviously something we didn't do very well. Sometimes when you think you're opposing something, instead of being the opposite of it, you're really being the other side of the coin. You haven't achieved something that really transcends and goes beyond it. Sexuality is interesting, because in American culture you have two apparent opposites. You have repressive Puritan views, and you have the proliferation of pornography and how it approach to sex. And they hate each other and they're opposites, but they really feed on each other. Without the repression, there wouldn't be such a market for pornography. Without the pornography, the people who promote repression wouldn't have such a good argument. So they're really two sides of the coin. The opposite to both of them is a healthy sexuality that's part of human relationships, where there's mutual respect and tenderness. That's the opposite to both of them. We work pornography, but we're much more just a crude negation of the repression. Everybody should sleep with everybody. It wasn't quite that bad in practice, but there are edges of that. Without respect, not only for commitment and responsibility, but it wasn't really something that was liberating women from the constrictions of the old society, because there was a lot of pressure on women to be sexually available, whether that was exactly what they felt in that situation or not. Part of the revolution is being able to apply your humanitarian ideals to your own human relationships. And we have to develop a process and a mode of struggle. I think the women's movement has taught some lessons on this. I think the Christian-based communities in Latin America have taught some lessons on this. No one has an exact model. But we have to develop a process of resolving issues, political debate, coming to decisions, which are democratic, which are respectful, ways to raise criticisms that are constructive, that are trying to move forward the ideals of the whole group rather than jockeying for position. Exactly how to do that, especially in the situation of the Weather Underground. Remember, this isn't just a group that can have meetings and can have democratic debate, and if the decision is wrong, well, we'll change it at the next convention. This is a group that's being hunted by the police. People can get killed. People can be put in prison for life. You can't have open debate. You can't have open meetings. In that situation, there's a lot of pressure to become a very disciplined organization, which is needed, and discipline is right. But with that discipline, especially in the culture we grow up in, there tends to be commandism, authoritarianism, status approach Are you in or out with leadership? Are you higher or lower in the hierarchy? Rather than full democratic debate based on the validity of ideas and the commitment to the ideals rather than someone's position in the organization. What's the answer to how to combine a disciplined combat organization with fully democratic and humane processes? I don't know. All I can say is it's a problem that we have to take on consciously. I don't see models of exactly how it's installed. It's something we have to be conscious of and take on. One thing that revolutionary groups need to function is funds. They usually don't get grants from the Rockefeller Foundation, the Ford Foundation, and especially by 81, there's much less of a mass movement and there's less support coming forward. People tend to rely on ways of taking funds to function. The grouping that was responsible for NIAC took the name Revolutionary Armed Task Force, but that just, it was a unit of the Black Liberation Army, and there were white revolutionaries like myself who worked with them, because it was in the context both of trying to build a revolutionary Black underground, and also funds were used to support programs in the community for the youth to keep revolutionary nationalism alive and functioning. So this same movie was accused of doing several money actions. This is one that went terribly wrong. The action was at the Nanuet Mall. There was an armored car that was picking up money. When they opened the back of the truck, some revolutionaries swooped down on it, freeze, guns out, handled the money. Evidently the guard lifted the gun to shoot at the shootout. The guard was killed. The guard inside was trying to close the truck, was shot in the arm. Money was taken off the truck. Later the police said it was about $1.6 million. Several miles away, a U-Haul truck was trying to get on the freeway. It was stopped. Police went to open the back door. People came out the back door. There was a shootout. Two police were killed, one was wounded. At that point, most people got away. Four people were in a car that crashed, in a light car that couldn't handle the turn and crashed. No, three people and were busted, and also Kathy Boudin was busted on the entrance to the freeway there. I was in a light car that was crashed. 2 days later, there, I guess based on lessons the police learned from ID and tracing cars and this and that, Kawaseku and Odinga and Antiari, Shabaka, Sumbiata was stopped and there was a shootout. Sumbiata was killed going over a fence. Sekou Odinga ran out of ammunition and surrendered. He walked into the police station in good shape. He came out in intensive care for 3 months. Those are just like the factual part. And then there was subsequent busts based on getting information. Sam Brown was one of the people in the car with me that crashed and got captured as a result of beatings to try to make us talk, but what happened to him was a lot worse than what happened to me. He ended up with two fractured vertebrae. He didn't get treatment until 11 weeks later to finally agree to talk to the FBI. And as a result of that information, they also picked up some other people later, so there was subsequent federal conspiracy trial. People did get killed, and that's tragic. It's particularly tragic for those families, you know, because people got killed on both sides. And I can certainly appreciate why it's painful for them. In asserting and affirming I'm a political prisoner, I don't mean to be flip. It's not like.
Humanize him a little bit, so destigmatize him a bit. So, What'd you guys think of it?
It's just an example of like types of people we write. A lot of the people he like made mentioned are people that we write. Kind of cool.
Cool.
No.
So before we start writing, we're gonna go over the do's and don'ts of writing to prisoners. And take it with a grain of salt. It's not a rule book or anything, but this is what we go by. It seems to work well. I don't know if that's what it is. Alright.
Do's and don'ts.
Can you guys think of any don'ts to start off?
Don't write anything that you don't want cops or prison staff to read in sensitive information.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
How would you prison? That's my number one. Our guide to writing prisoner, but don't write something that you wouldn't feel comfortable with saying in front of police officer.
Don't want to focus too heavily on whatever crime they did. If you don't know what they did, I don't know how it would be appropriate to ask.
I mean, I think it's okay to prevent it, yeah. Not be like focused so much on it, but don't be like scared to say anything about it.
Right, yeah. Especially for like the first time that you're writing to a political prisoner or a prisoner, you don't want to be like, so what did you do to get in here?
Yeah.
That's more what I was,
Alright,
focus. Do everyone want to come in?
Okay, another one?
Oh, shit on them?
Yes.
What?
I have written down, don't place political judgments on prisoners' experiences. Don't expect a reply right away. Or at all.
Say it takes like normally like 2 weeks for a letter to get. Like to the prisoner once you mail it, because there's a whole, not just to get there, but also like they're all read and all that. So,
yeah.
Process.
And also a lot of the times too, prisoners have limited resources. So like paper and pens and stamps. So they, and also I know some prisons, they only allow a certain number of letters that each prisoner can send out. And so usually that's prioritized to their family or friends. So yeah, don't take it personally. But. And yeah, and I guess the last one that I can think of is the too nosy, which kind of goes with this one, focus on the crime. But yeah, because when you're first introducing yourself to someone in person, you're not nosy, right? Yeah, so I'd say it's the same thing. Okay, can you guys think of any others? No? Okay, so how about the do's? So, first one, be yourself. Be real. Don't have to make it overly complicated.
Normal, like meet someone. Also, like the first time you met, like a prisoner, like introduce yourself and like talk about your life and like what you're interested in and why you're writing them. Yeah, I think we focus a lot on like what we're doing on campus when we write and just a lot about our like about ourselves. And then like ask them questions about themselves. So I have. So maybe addressing some of your concerns about like, oh, I don't know what to write about. Some people feel like that writing prisoners is hard because you don't want to like depress them or like they're already in this shitty place and you don't want to remind them of that. And it's just weird, like maybe meeting a stranger. But also they're already homesick and they already are aware of their situation. And so maybe like reaching out and contacting them is brighten their day. So yeah, it's a breath of fresh air. So,
yeah, generally speaking.
Yeah, generally speaking.
Yeah. It doesn't happen with all prisoners, but yeah. So yeah, it is definitely okay to talk about what you're doing outside of prison.
And I think it's a good thing to talk about yourself and because it reinforces that like your life, like life isn't just prison. Like there are things going on the outside that can maybe give them hope, like that the world is still going on.
Yeah. And then with asking questions, it could be anything to get to know a person, right? Like what's your favorite music? What are your interests and passions? So yeah, those are some basic things you can start out with. I think it's always a good idea to, in your first letter, to ask about mailing restrictions, so you're aware and you can respect his or her wishes. But be patient, and that goes with not expecting a reply. And also just a technicality, like write their address on both the envelope and inside the letter. So.
And on each page.
Yes.
We're writing birthday cards today, and I already wrote the address on this side of the card. Just
cool. Did that answer your question a little bit? Like, does that give you more clarity?
Especially the initial like, letter that you want to send, like what music.
Yeah. Good.
you want, we have some letters that you could respond to if you want to do like a longer letter. We also have, this is our birthday calendar, so every month we like go through and we write whoever's birthday, political prisoner's birthday it is, and then we write like a little bio about them so you know like what to write in your birthday card or whatever. I haven't filled out April yet, even though I have the cards. So if we want to do that, it's just kind of like what we do at prison writing, so like, make this like that.
Yeah. And you guys, do anything that you're comfortable with. You don't have to write if you don't want to. And if you just wanted to read some letters that we've gotten in the past, you can do that. Or if you want to write birthday cards, you can do that too. And then you wanted to check out also some zines. We brought a few zines about prisoner letter writing. And this goes over in more depth what we just talked about. So good to look at this. Here are a list of political prisoners around the world. And this is a flyer on when we meet, if you guys are interested in joining.
I can pull up the website that has all of their bios on it if you want to meet before you put a response in the card.
Thank you.
recording.
I like your
I actually got this from, have you ever heard of radical mycology?
Yeah, I actually just saw that the other day.
Yeah, I helped someone support the release of their book.
Yeah,
and they sent like a huge package of like stickers and patches and stuff.
All of this
it's a great book.
Yeah, that's rad. I just saw that the other day.
It's really good. That's kind of what they're into is restorative ecology, using mycology.
Okay. Well, I was just guessing.
Yeah.
That's neat stuff.
So this website, you have to scroll through and find their names, but it shows like their affiliation and then how many years they've been in prison and like a website about that. It's not even up there, but you want to come over here. I also brought a few thank you cards if you want to write thank you cards to someone.
First name Mumia, or is it the first name Abu?
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
I know.